live on Trainboy54's Phineas and Ferb Season 4 Reviews. It's the Phineas and Ferb Cliptastic Countdown, hosted by Kelly Osbourne. Appearing today's review, the creator of Tommy and Trackmaster TNF, yours truly, Trainboy54. He's the star, he's yellow. Please welcome Acleotype 4427. And our guest stars, Sam the Thomas Fan 1. And a fan of Trainboy54's Adventures of Phineas and Ferb, D. Coleman H. And now, our host for the Phineas and Ferb Season 4 Reviews, Trainboy54!
Hi, everybody! Welcome to my 13th review of Phineas and Ferb Season 4. And it's a pleasure of you guys to star in my P&F Season 4 reviews.
Oh, that's no problem at all, John.
Oh, that was no problem at all, John.
I'm so excited. We get to star in Trainboy54's Phineas and Ferb Season 4 reviews.
That's right. Now let's begin the review. The Phineas and Ferb Cliptastic Countdown, hosted by Kelly Osbourne. The opening part of the episode was great, not bad. The crowd was cheering pretty good, I like that. But Dr. Heinz Doofenshmirtz interrupted the announcer at this minute. He was like, yeah, we know the drill. We've hosted before. He's good, I'm evil, blah blah blah. And Major Monogram is like, I for one am excited to be here. And then the announcer says, let me finish my introduction, will you too? Thank you. Anyway, welcome to the Phineas and Ferb's musical Cliptastic Countdown, hosted by Kelly Osbourne. And now, here's our host. She's a singer, an actor, a fashionista du jour, Kelly Osbourne! Wow, Kelly Osbourne? As a host of the Phineas and Ferb musical Cliptastic Countdown? I didn't know that Kelly Osbourne is the host of the show. What do you guys think about her?
I guess she did really good as host.
Gotta say, she is so splendid. In fact, when I thought her in this episode, I thought, wow, how are they gonna make her into a cartoon? And then when I saw her in real life action, I was all like, whoa! That's awesome! You would never expect that, wouldn't you? It's really awesome.
Well, let's just say that I'm glad that she's not the nostalgic critic. Because if she was, we would be saying sparkle, sparkle, sparkle nonstop. Also, she'd be doing the remembering for us so we wouldn't have to.
Uh-huh. Just as I thought. Even though Kelly Osbourne is the host of the show, Major Monogram and Dr. Doofenshmirtz are the co-hosts. Well, what do you think of that?
I'd have to say that is pretty lame, but I guess it brings a little bit of humor into the show. And I think we all can agree that it was completely obvious that Dr. Doofenshmirtz wasn't going to agree that this was going to happen. So I just think it's okay.
And it's pretty good also.
I'm not sure. Those two never got used to each other.
Dang! So they are now playing number 10 of all of the Phineas and Ferb songs from seasons 2 through 3. Candace Party from Candace Gets Busted. I had liked that song before. It was awesome. What do you guys think of that song?
Such a catchy song. And I can actually understand why it's number 10. I mean, not exactly one of the most really, really fantabulous Phineas and Ferb songs, but it's still a great song.
Man, that song makes me want to dance a little!
It's a good song. I got interested in it after watching John's 10th Phineas and Ferb adventure.
Very interesting. After the song was over, Kelly waves and blows a kiss to the camera, And Dr. Doofenshmirtz is like, demoted to co-host. And Kelly Osbourne? Well, she's like, I've been a co-host before. And I had a blast doing it. Well, goody gumdrops for you. And now they're playing number 9 of the next Phineas and Ferb songs. Come Home Perry from... Oh, there you are, Perry. The song was made on account of Perry being missing, so Phineas and Ferb formed a band to conjure Perry back with music. What do you think?
Appropriate song. If it was called Perry Come Home, I'd be having deja vu to a Charlie Brown movie called Snoopy Come Home.
Such a lovely song. It really grabs everyone's attention, and it really proves that Perry is one of the most famous characters on Phineas and Ferb, and that it shows that everyone in the town loves him. I think it was really sweet.
This is the greatest song I've ever heard! I sure think it's the greatest song I've ever heard, even my precious!
Okay. After the song ended, Kelly Osbourne is like, we seriously have to do something about your fashion. It's just not working. What she meant by that is Major Monogram and Dr. Doofenshmirtz have to change their clothes into a different fashion.
I say that's a bit selfish. I mean, they don't have to wear any outfits. It was just an opinion. I didn't see why they had to take it out. I didn't see why Kelly had to change the outfit like that. They could have just stayed where they were, but yeah, I think Kelly Osbourne's thought was just a bit selfish, you know.
If it's for their own good, then I guess they must.
Well, I guess they do need some upbeat fuel in fashion.
While Major Monogram and Dr. Doofenshmirtz are backstage getting changed, they play number 8 of the next Phineas and Ferb song. I'm Me from The Necessary Roughness. When Vanessa was singing that song, I was like, woo! Yeah! Woo! Baby! Oh yeah! Sing it!
The number is highlighted by its demonstration of Vanessa's sharp attitude and accompanies her struggle to acquire a rare chemical for her father so as to prove herself responsible and earn a car of her own.
Rock and roll, baby!
I'm Me is sort of like a really fantabulous episode, song. But there are no words, it's just a good song. I don't really care for it that much.
Vanessa sure was being Vanessa in that song, but I'm being me by looking like a chunk of cloud that just fell from the sky.
Not bad thoughts! After that, Doofenshmirtz and Monogram come back on stage dressed up like Kelly, right down to her purple hair. Oh, how embarrassing is that?
Ah! It's too geeky! It's too geeky!
Ugh. And I thought the dress code for the magical land of Cordor was embarrassing.
I'd have to say that's just weird. Let's agree that that's just weird.
Then, Kelly, Monogram, and Doofenshmirtz are striking different poses.
Oh, that part with Osbourne, Doof, and Monogram voguing it out? Yeah, I didn't think that was really that good.
Oh my gosh, I think my kiwis just bursted by the awesomeness of that clip.
Blue is on violets, red is on roses. If I was flexible enough, I'd do much better poses. They're not the worst ones I've seen. I'd rather ask God's friend, Moses.
Dr. Doofenshmirtz was like, but vouching was my idea. Then he leaves the stage. And Major Monogram starts number 7 of the next Phineas and Ferb song, Aglet, from Tip of the Day.
Aglet is a song from the episode Tip of the Day, describing the importance of what is at the end of a shoelace. An aglet.
Well, I don't have a thought for that, so you guys do the thoughts for me.
You know what, that song is really catchy. You can't really get that line out of that head if you think about it. A-G-L-E-T, aglet, don't forget it. Yes. it's actually a great song to motivate people into doing stuff, which makes it a bad good of a song.
At first I thought it was a rip-off of the Bingo song, you know, and Bingo was his name-o. But all in all, it was a really good song.
Sure brought back the memory of shoelaces. I mean that literally.
Thank you. Now Major Monogram is back in his normal clothes, and they play number 6 of the next Phineas and Ferb song, City of Love, from the Phineas and Ferb special, Summer Belongs to You. That was performed by Isabella as she tries to persuade Phineas to relax with her and enjoy their stay in Paris.
Romantic? That song should be used for a 2014 Valentine's Day special.
City of Love kinda shows how much Isabella cares about Phineas, but it makes me angry that Phineas has no idea that Isabella has feelings for him. On the opinion of the song itself, it's a really sweet episode, and I really love it. You know, because it's a lovely thing.
That was okay. Sure brought back the feeling of romance. Gosh, when is Phineas and Isabella gonna hook up?
Good. End of Act 1.